September 12th, 2 a.m. Rain's been coming down for days and the river's rising. Sirens call, gotta get out of town. A friend and his wife, his old guitar, they grabbed what they could and threw it in the car. The road's washing out of the canyon. It's a state of mind to help those that you love. Seeing all that river ripped apart, push came to shove, time was running out. Run. He said, some of the neighbors, stubborn as a mule, gonna ride it out up on the butte. Well, there's no getting round, the highway's gone. Like nothing they've ever seen before, cars floating by. The river ran down Main Street, they didn't get far. It took so much not to give up anymore. So they waited for the shadow up on higher ground. At daybreak and lifted all that was left of the town. On the outside looking in, like watching a surgeon recklessly cutting into someone you love. Now the water's fanning out across the floodplains. Rivers changing course, new farms in open range. This land may never, ever be the same. Of one another, whatever it takes, rise once again, rise.
Good evening, everybody. My name is Justin Roth. I'm really glad to be here with JamPlay again, here to talk about some partial capos. These are some things you've probably seen of a little bit of before, but maybe if you've ever been handed one without being told a few things behind them, you might throw it on the guitar and it makes your guitar sound really weird and complicated. But there's some really easy keys to using these things that I want to demonstrate quickly to you guys that really kind of makes this open up your what you can get out of the acoustic guitar sonically without complicating what you're playing, because I'm just going to be talking in standard tuning in this whole lesson. I don't know if in that last song whether you noticed it I'm in standard tuning, but by the use of a partial capo was kind of getting some droning strings as if I was in an altered tuning. However, the convenience of using these things makes it so that you can get some of that altered tuning, richer chord sounds without having to retune your guitar, without having to learn new chords, and getting the benefit all from the capos. So just as a quick intro, if you haven't seen these before, obviously probably all familiar with standard capos. You put them on, play a chord, put the capo on, it raises the key. Simple enough. The partial capos, I'm going to be talking about two different ones here today, and these are Kaiser capos. There's a lot of other manufacturers that make different capos in these same voicings and other voicings, but I use Kaisers and have for years and love them. The first one is called the drop D capo, so I don't know, you can see that maybe on the, that it's got the basically a slot knocked out for the low string to ring through and past the capo. So the way that this capo got the name drop D capo is some of you have maybe tried drop D tuning before, which involves you know, actually lowering the tuning of the string of your low E string down one whole step to D. So I'm just going to demonstrate that real quick. So the whole idea behind doing that is that then you can play this D chord and still have a low bass note, because before the low bass note, of course, was assigned to your E chord. So, this is a really great thing to have. However, is when you go to play any chord that is based off of the low string, because you've retuned, the bass note from where it used to be has moved. So if I were to go to play a G chord, for instance, doesn't sound right because that G note has moved. So granted, it's only one string, but that's having to refret something, a chord that you already know. So the way that these capos work are trying to eliminate some of those finger changes where you don't have to fret different chords, that all your notes are still going to be in the same place because we're always in standard tuning. That instead of tuning a string down, we're capoing different strings up. So everything above the capo is still in standard tuning. All your notes are where you're familiar with them being, except that some notes will ring past the capo and then giving you that altered tuning sound without actually putting yourself into an altered tuning. So let's get back to standard. So first demonstration, that drop D capo with the low string cut out. Obviously, what I just demonstrated, we lowered the E down to D. The note we're hearing was actually D because we're playing a D chord without a capo on the guitar. So this is the one, the little flip side of this is that the drop D name comes from the fact that I'm going to put this on the second fret, and I'm going to play a D chord. So you may be saying right away, you're like, well, that's not a D chord because it's capoed up. So the note we're hearing, as far as a bass player is concerned, is E. But for this example, I'm using the D shape here. So that's just a D chord. But because the low string is not covered by the capo, now I've got that drop D tuning sound. I have the bass note on my D chord. However, if I go to play the G chord, like I demonstrated last time, that bass note's still where it's supposed to be, or where we're familiar with it being. So I don't have to change anything in my left hand to fret the chord differently. So now, easy enough. So that's kind of the one simple payoff that this gets in this capo position. I'm going to demonstrate moving it up the neck and how it changes what we play above it. But so if that's the freebie, is getting that extra bass note on the D chord because it's not covered, the one place to balance out the ease of that is that there's one thing that you have to work a little bit harder to do. And that is, say I was going to play an E minor chord in this key. E minor chord looks like that. However, if this was a full capo, that string would be covered by the capo, but it's not in this instance. So this is one thing where I've got to work a little harder, and you just reach around behind it to get that bass note. Feels a little awkward at first, I'll admit that, but think of it in terms of if you were doing a bar chord, and we know how awkward those can feel sometimes, and how hard you have to press to cover all the strings. The good thing about this is the capo's doing most of the work. All you've got to get is that one string behind there. And you've got your E minor chord. So and there it is. So I've seen some people, I tend to put the capo directly behind the fret. I've just found intonation is better there, and also visually it just kind of tells me where the ending point is, and it feels like the nut wood on the end of the guitar. But I have seen, if that reaches a bit much for you, I know the last lesson they were talking about whether or not the size of your hand can reach different things. If this feels awkward and be like a big stretch to you, you can just move this back a little bit. You know, everything else above the capo will still be fine, and you can just use that as a way to get that bass note, if that's a little easier for you. However, I just find it a little visually challenging, especially if it's halfway back and you're thinking 2.5 frets up. So, I'm going to demonstrate the other partial capo now on the second fret, and then later on we're going to get on to moving it on up the neck so you can kind of hear the different sounds that you're able to get. So again, that's the drop D capo. The other one here is called the shortcut capo. Basically has, similar to the drop D, it's got the low E string cut out, but then it also does not cover the top E and B, or the, you know, first and second string. So it's basically covering your A, D, and G string when you put it over the top of the neck like this. So so again, if I put that onto the second fret, just in exact same place that the full capo, the drop D capo was, I can start out again with the D chord. That sounds just like the drop D capo did because this low bass string is ringing past it. However, in this position, when it's on the second fret, I now have the option, and for now you can just take it for granted that it's legal to do this, and then we'll explain a little bit more why it is a little bit down the road, is that I have the option to not fret either of the top two strings in any chord that I play in this key. So, for example, that's fretting the normal D chord. I can take one finger off, and that high E string rings open and works. I can take that finger off, and now my D chord has been moved down to a one finger chord. Now when you're playing, you may choose to leave some one or the other or neither of them on, depending on the voicing you want. So all of a sudden now you've got three choices behind that chord without having to like reach anywhere else on the neck. And now this is starting to sound like an open tuning. If any of you have experimented with open tunings before, in Dadgad in particular, which I won't go too far into that, but I just want to demonstrate what this is doing in relationship to the idea of playing in an altered tuning. In the tuning of Dadgad, which is from low to high, D-A-D, G-A-D, you're essentially lowering both of your E strings down a whole step to D, and lowering your B string down a whole step to A. So instead of retuning, as much as I absolutely love that tuning, when you do that, your chord shapes are all different because the relationship from string to string has changed. Here, what I've done is kind of the reverse of it, but not entirely. Instead of lowering the first, second, and sixth string down a whole step, I've essentially just raised the pitch of the third, fourth, and fifth string up one whole step. I haven't retuned it, but strummed open, that sounds just like Dadgad would if I was in Dadgad, but with a full capo on the second fret, because my lowest note is actually E instead of tuning it down to D. So there, if that's starting to sound familiar for any of you who have played in Dadgad, that is why. So however, instead of being in an altered tuning and having to learn new chords, now, as I mentioned before, my D chord can be the regular D or simplified to a one finger D chord. My G chord is still exactly where I'm used to it being. However, played like that, it doesn't sound any different than it normally would, so it's not really getting the benefit of the partial capo. So in all the chords in this key, the same rule is going to apply where that I can choose not to fret either of the top two strings. So it'll sound like this. So now that, in terms of theory, we've got that's a G9 chord, but we don't have to know that. If we know that you like it, that's why we play it at this point. So I've taken my G chord and simplified it down to a one or two finger chord, and it sounds really nice and rich and open. And if I was playing this in just regular standard tuning with a regular capo, I might have to reach to get some of those notes. And so let's go to an A chord. If this was a standard capo, a normal A would sound like this. But because the top two strings aren't covered, now I can take one finger off. So you got a little bit of dissonance built in right there with the normal fingering of the chord, instead of, again, having to learn a more complicated chord. And I can take my pinky off. So now I've got another, again, really open droning chord. So now, let's just compare the difference of playing, Well, here, I'll just demonstrate the E minor chord too, and then we'll do a little chord progression to hear the difference. So an E minor chord. Here again, having to reach the bass note behind the capo. So far, that sounds normal, but now the top two strings sound like that. Again, probably not a chord that you could reach with one hand to get that same voicing, but here it is without us having to do anything really different than we would normally play it in standard tuning, except for reaching behind the capo. So now, I'll play the standard version covering the top two strings just to hear D, G, and A, and E minor, how it would normally sound, and then I'll take the fingers or the fretted notes off of the top two strings and we can hear the difference. So that's more or less normal, like it would be if that was a standard capo. Now, utilizing the capo to the fullest extent. So it doesn't sound like standard tuning anymore. However, all I'm having to think about is D, G, A, E minor. I'm not thinking about where my notes have moved to or anything. It's all still familiar territory. And now the capo is allowing certain things to ring past to open up some new options. So this one's kind of the secret key. And we're gonna get to a point where we're sure about using both of them together. But I wanna show you what this thing can do as we move our way up the neck. So there's one kind of main key to remember when using any of these capos, even including the standard capo. And I'm going to show you that real quick, and then we'll move them on up. So the general idea behind moving capos up or down the neck is that, let's take a look at this, a regular E chord right now. It's our E chord with no capo. Now, typically with a standard capo, again the black one, but you can kind of think of this from darkest to lightest. I'm using the black one. This is a full-on standard capo. Now, if I just play an E chord right there, we have an E. If I put a capo on the second fret and I play an E chord shape, we've essentially raised the pitch one whole step. So now we're at F sharp. But guitar players are notorious for talking in terms of patterns as opposed to notes. We might say, oh, it's in E with a capo on the second fret. And that works for other guitar players, but your bass player is going to say you're not playing in E. So that's where we get some flack for that. However, the other way to use these, instead of just using it to raise or lower the key and playing the same chord shapes, it's a great transposition tool. So the way that works is going back to this E chord with no capo. If I want to use this to transpose to a different chord shape as opposed to transposing to a different key, all I have to remember is that if I go, in this example, if I go one whole step up, which is two frets, then I will take the chord that I was playing, the E, and I'll move it one whole step down, or two half steps down. So one whole step down from E would be D. That's how I know that I've gone a whole step up with the capo, a whole step down the scale with the chord shape, and now I've got a D. We're still hearing E, our bass player still gets to play E, but that's how I've been able to transpose this. And I can do it again. So if I go another whole step up, then I'll take that D chord and go a whole step down to C. We're still hearing E again. Bass player still slapping away on the E. So that's how I transpose my chords down, and that's a lot of times when you see two guitar players playing together, one's capoed up, one's not, and they're both playing familiar chord shapes, but they just have transposed it. So you can do that all the way up or down the neck. I'm just moving in increments that keep it on the whole notes instead of talking about B flats and C sharps and things like that, because there are convenient places, or places that are far more convenient to use these partial capos than others. So when I move on to the drop D capo, that same rule applies. Here was my E, let's say E, A, and B. with no capo. If I use the drop D capo on the second fret, that E goes down a whole step to D, and that still works. The A goes down a whole step to G, and the B goes down a whole step to A. So that's how I've been able to think of that, to move it on up. So the thing, same thing is going to work again. If I go a whole step up, that what was a D chord when the capo was on the second fret is going to go down a whole step to C. So now this is where, with the partial capo, that means this C shape is actually playing, you know, an E chord that we're hearing. And that low E bass note still works. So if you're a solo player and you play a lot of acoustic songs or whatever by yourself, and you capo them up because you have certain key shapes that you like to play out of, but you know that the higher you capo up, the more low notes and bigness of your guitar, you're losing it. So this is a great way to supplement that as well, because as you move up, you can still keep your bass notes. Still have the voicings voiced higher the way that you like them. You might say, Justin, I like that, but all my songs are in F, and I'm playing in E right now. You're like, well, what do I do? It's like, well, that's where the regular capo, in conjunction with the partial capo, comes in handy. The regular capo, using it the way that we typically use it, just raising the key. If I know that this shape, I'm actually playing in the key of E, but I want to be in F, which is a half step up, I'll use the standard full capo to raise my lowest pitch up one half step to F, and I slide that up one more fret, so it's four frets above that capo. Now I'm in F. And there you go. You can do that. Keep that relationship and move it up to G or whatever key works for you. Okay, so that's the drop D capo. Now let's hear what the shortcut capo does as we move it up past the second fret, which we've already demonstrated. So I'll do this part quick, and then we'll get up to the fourth fret to hear what that's doing. So again, our E, A, and B chord. Going up one whole step to the second fret. E is going to go down one whole step to D. And I've got those options to not fret the top two strings. What was an A chord without a capo goes down one whole step to G. There we go, with those voicings. And the B chord would go down one whole step to A. There we go. So now the same rule is going to apply. If I move it another whole step up, I can just trust that these open ringing strings are going to work over this chord in these chords in this key. Because remember, we're still playing in the key of E. We're just changing our chord shapes. And in the key of E, we've got two E strings right here and a B string, which is like the fifth of the E chord. So it just works in the key, and the B is, well, they're both the high strings end up becoming the extra notes that become color or suspensions on top of the chords, and they're kind of the freebies that we get from the capo. So here on the fourth fret, what was a D chord when we were capoed on the second fret goes down a whole step to C. What was a G chord goes down a whole step to F. And then what was an A chord goes down a whole step to G. So to me, it's starting to sound like, it doesn't sound like altered tuning as much anymore. And again, this comes in so handy for if you're solo or acoustic solo or duo player, because it just can diversify the sound that you're able to get from the guitar. And maybe you would use it you know, only on a handful of songs or half the songs, or if you feel like a lot of your songs start to sound the same because you play in the same keys or the same chord shapes, this is a great way to diversify it a little bit so that in a show, your guitar is kind of taking on a different character for different songs. The other fun thing about this one, because it's not covering the top two strings, once we get up to, say, to the fourth fret here, there's a thing that we need to remember is that, and this it does apply to when you're on the second fret, but more even more so when you're on the fourth fret, is that we have three strings that are still available to us behind the capo. So this requires knowing a little bit more about where your scales are, but in the key of E, you, for starters, just looking at the second or fourth fret of each of those strings, and I guess up to the fifth, is you have the option, especially if you can be selective on what you're strumming and not just strumming all the open strings. If I just strum the bass note, and then if you're into finger picking, this is where this capo really lends itself to creating a lot more melodic opportunities. So if I just play the bass note and then can pick things with my right hand to make more of a melody in the guitar part. So you get the idea. There's notes available to you behind the capo. So all of a sudden up here we're able to think of the chord shapes that we're in or the key that we're in. Up here we're able to think of the scale, and you can do the same on bass notes. So don't forget about these guys. They're not lost souls. They're still good for something. Okay, cool. Well, and the other thing is because I mentioned that these top two strings are still in the key that we're playing in, I'm just demonstrating right now the 1, 4, and 5 chords. Like in this instance, C, F, and G. However, those droning strings are going to work over every chord in this key. And meaning, what I mean by that is, again, since I'm playing the key of C shapes. So in the key of C shapes, going up the scale, we've got C. Our two chord would be D minor. And the character of these droning strings are going to change depending on what chord is underneath it. So they're essentially still in the key, but you may or may not like what they're adding. So there's our two chord. Our three chord would be an E minor. And again, I have to reach behind the capo to get the bass note. Our four chord. Five is a G. Six would be A minor. To fret or not to fret. And so there you have it. And that'll be the same for when it's on the second fret, playing in the key of D shapes. Which maybe I'll just do that quick, just so you can hear it. So in the key of D, we got D, E minor, F sharp minor, and that one I'm barring the whole thing because that one doesn't sound as nice. Our four chord is G, five is an A, six is a B minor. Again, to choose whether or not to fret any of those top two strings. So that'll work as you go on up. So a great starter place for this, and we've got more videos on the website. I do some other workshops on this, as well as a few other instructors talking about partial capos that you can explore further to get into what's actually happening, the theory of it. And I don't want to bog you down too much in the theory right now. But so there you have that. All sorts of options and all sorts of colors you can get. And your left hand will be very happy that it doesn't have to reach these monstrous chords to get them sounding rich and open and as if you're in an alto tuning. So your left hand will thank you. So as we go on up, now we have the option of using both the drop D and the shortcut capo together, which is, again, it's kind of creates a different opportunity. Some things work better than others. But if we go back to the example of having the shortcut capo, it's, again, just covering the A, D, and G string on the fourth fret. That's where we're thinking of the key of C shapes, because we were at E. Second fret, we were thinking D. Fourth fret, we're thinking C. So what you can do is, all these examples so far have been using the low bass note as the root of the one chord. Like I was using that underneath the C chord. So what you can start to do is, and that's where these open strings work the, how would you say, they're the most sonorous, meaning they're not creating nearly as much tension. They're just kind of giving you extra drones or unisons or a ninth, sometimes a minor seventh on top. Now, as we're going to start to move it around of where this low bass note fits with the other chords underneath it, it's going to change how complex those top two droning strings sound over the chords underneath them. So let's, instead of saying that this C shape is our one chord and going C, F, G, let's say the C chord is our five chord. So this is having to do a little theory. So I'm just going to do a little bit of it for you, because I don't want to, if you've been watching these lessons all day long, your brain is probably pretty full right now. So I'm going to do some of that work for you now and encourage you to watch some of the other videos on the website after a good night's rest. So if this C shape is our five, a fifth down from C would be F. So now let's start with this. Say F is our one chord. Those top droning strings still work. Our four chord would be B flat. And now we get to use the low bass note on our five chord. So that still works. That's another way to change up the keys that you're actually working in without always using the lowest bass note on the root of the one chord. So as one more example, let's look at if this C shape was the root of our four chord. So then we'd have to go a fourth down from C would be G. So now if that's our one chord, again, we have the option to not fret the top two strings. And the further we go down this road, the more dissonant these top two droning strings are going to sound over some of these chords, but they're always going to be in the key. So they are totally legal and usable notes. Not that we're all about following rules here in music, but just so you know. So G is our one. Our four chord now gets the bass note. And our five chord would be D. So I'm fretting the top two right now because that's pretty dissonant extra note on top. If it serves the song, then use it. If it doesn't, then fret it the way it normally would be. So that's the other great thing about this, is you've always got, on a lot of these chords, you've got three options to determine which voicing serves the song or the emotion that you're trying to get across. So without having, again, to having to reach for something more, it's actually just making it simpler to play and making it more complex to hear, or the sound of it is more complex. So it's kind of counterintuitive in that way. So going from this place, this is where it gets fun when we start to use the two capos, is in this position where we are using this position, having the C chord be our four chord. So now we're going to think of the key of G shapes to go G, C, and D. Now, if I use the drop D capo, again, just leaving the low bass note open, and putting that on the second fret, that by itself made us think D shapes. This by itself made us think C shapes to work. And now all that this one is doing, our low bass note still rings through both of these all the way down to the nut. The next three strings are stopped by this, and now this is stopping only the top two strings. So all it is changing is the color of the top two droning strings over the chords that we were just playing, the G, C, and D. So So that G sounds like that. The C gets the bass note. And now the D. So just to compare, that compared to that. The C chord compared to. So here, with this capo on, you're getting a little more color on that chord. The D chord, that one I can ring all the way open. Without that one, kind of has a little spooky tension to it. So now the same rules are going to apply. Again, like if I wanted to play the E minor chord. Now, if you do have quite a reach on your hands, you have, say we wanted the bass note. This is a stretch, literally and figuratively. Ah, I missed it. I'm fretting the bass note down here, just so I can get the bass note of that D. So now I get the whole. So there's that. That's really kind of the tip of the iceberg with these things. I came to using these, using them in altered tunings, and they work beautifully for that too. But this is a great way to, if you're really comfortable in standard tuning and want to start to expand your sonic palette, but don't want to start venturing into having to retune on stage. But want to get more of those colors in your chords. This is a great way to keep your left hand in familiar territory, get a lot more colors out of the guitar without having to change a whole lot, and you don't break nearly as many strings as you do when you go to altered tunings. So, a couple tips about using these to kind of wrap up here is again I mentioned I tend to put them, the capos, right behind the fret. Intonation to me seems to be the best. Visually, it's a lot easier to kind of know where your ending point is. And as you use the capos, I'll demonstrate one thing in a sec. As you use these, the one thing you want to avoid is, and I see a lot of people doing this, is they take their capos off, they tune their guitar with their tuner, and then they put their capos on. Now the problem with that is, one, you're tuning before you have these on there, which may, you know, it's going to change things. And the way it's going to change it is all the different capo manufacturers have different amounts of tension on how tightly they squeeze the strings. Plus, depending on who makes your guitar and how fat the neck is on your guitar is going to affect how tightly these are. So the fatter the neck, the tighter that these are going to be, because these are kind of a set tension. While some other brands have different, a screw that you can change the amount of tension. So as you put these on, especially when you think of using two, each one of these is putting a certain amount of tension on your strings. Now, if you use light gauge strings, you're going to find that it starts to pull those strings sharp a little bit. So what my practice of using these things is I always put them on, again, before tuning, and I grab the strings just with my right hand, give a little pull to them. It just makes sure there's no extra slack behind them, and then you can go from there to fine-tune things. Granted, if you're looking at a tuner and you need to know what notes they are, that's the one little learning thing you'll have to figure out. But they'll all be relatively close, but you can do fine-tuning after you put these on. And the only thing that can affect your tuning more than using two of these is using three of them. So again, here I've got this C chord with this low E note in the bass, but that one person who said, all my songs are in F, I want to make it an F. It's like, okay, we can do that. Let's raise it a half step and then take our standard full capo, put it on the first fret to raise it to F. Now we have it in F, and now my guitar's slightly out of tune. There you go. Now you've got three capos on there. If you play in bars, it kind of helps keep people off the stage because it kind of looks scary. Also, the reason I like the Kaisers is when I'm not using them, I can just stick them up here on the headstock. They're out of the way. I'm not going to forget them on the mic stand. They're good to go. And that's that. So it's been great to be here with you. I look forward to hearing some of your questions, if I anything else I can answer. And what are you going to do? We'll do the giveaway? Questions,
yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, we're going to get to some questions, but since it's right at the top of the hour, we're going to go ahead and do the giveaway. Is this for the guitar or the gift
card?
All right. Yeah. So this is for a $100 Amazon gift card, and because this is a gift card, this is open even to our viewers that are across the pond from us, so that will make you eligible as well. As Jeff has said all day long, to be entered, you should have been participating in the chat room, and you must be here at this time. You will be given 2 minutes after Jeff posts the name in the chat room, and we give the name here. And you'll have 2 minutes to respond and let us know that you are here, and we can get that off to you. So I'll turn it over to Jeff here.
My friends, the time is upon us. A great prize, a $100 gift card to Amazon. Hopefully, you'll use it for something music-related, but we obviously can't enforce that. And the winner, the first winner, hopefully the only winner, is Sean Eckel. Sean Eckel, just let us know that you're here and actively watching the event. You've got 2 minutes. Yep. Justin's waiting, and he looks very angry. If you're not here...
Yeah, this is my angry face.
Who knows what could happen. Sean Eckel. We do have the runners-up already picked if he's not here anymore. Oh, he's here. Okay, Sean Eckel, just please send us your shipping information to support@jamplay.com, and we will send you a $100 Amazon gift card in the mail. And so now Justin's going to do some questions with Jason, and then Jim Deeming will be up next, and we have one more guitar.
All right.
All right, let's get to some questions. All right, we have run. Obviously, we're a little over. We're trying to get to as many questions as we possibly can. There are a lot, so we do apologize if we don't get to yours. But this first one up here is from Fulton. Asks, would it be better for a beginner to just use a regular capo at first before trying to learn how to use these?
Well, I'd have two answers for that. One, definitely a standard capo is a regular standard capo is what people from when they're first learning, they usually have one of those because it's just the simple thing of put it on, you just use it to change your chords or move your keys up and down, and that is well and good. I think you should, every beginner should just have a regular capo anyway. You're not going to get the chord changes or the chord voicing changes out of that standard capo, but the convenience of having one of those is hands down a good investment to have. The flip side of that answer would be, though, is instead of having to do all this math and saying, like, okay, if I move it up a whole step, I got to move my chords down a whole step, just as a starting place, if you do just say the shortcut capo and just say, just put it on the second fret and play your D chords in the key of D. And now you have the option to simplify some of these chords to 1 and 2 finger chords. So as a beginner, some of those chords might actually be easier to play. Especially as a beginner, I know the tips of your fingers get pretty angry. Until you get those calluses, it can feel like, one, you can feel like your hands are too small, I'll never be able to push these strings down. So I know that that's a challenge at the beginning. This might be a way around that to simplify some of those chords to 1 or 2 finger chords, which just make it easier to play. So you can kind of look at it either way. Although it is good to learn the full chords. I don't want you to skip that altogether. So, all right.
All right, next one. And this one isn't necessarily on the capos, but this goes back to your opening song. And so Mikhail Mendoza asks, do you have any advice on singing and strumming at the same time? I always feel like I'm strumming with every syllable.
Yes, I totally know what that feels like. I had been playing guitar for a couple years before I ever tried singing with it. I would sing separately, and I would play separately, and everything was working, and then try to do them together, and it was a train wreck. Because your vocals tend to, all of a sudden, you think that every downbeat on the guitar is where the vocal is supposed to sit, too. Unfortunately, as far as tips, there's no real substitute for time on that, because I think over time, as I've sung songs, and I'm a singer, solo singer-songwriter, that things tend to start to move more naturally where my phrasing is not attached to my right hand, in terms of every time I strum down doesn't mean I have to be singing on a downbeat. So as far as singing goes, maybe one way to do it is get rid of the, maybe if it's a song that you're writing, forget the words, just sing like a syllable, like ooh, and try to just hold it out through the chord changes. And eventually you're going to have to take a breath and come back in. So it might just be a way to like disassociate where the melody is breaking relative to your strumming pattern. It might just be a way to start it, because I think with words sometimes we can get choppy with I want to dun dun and then I play over here and it goes like this, which kind of sounds like the Proclaimers, you know, and other people have done a lot of that and it works really well for them too. But so that's a long answer. Time, unfortunately, is the key, but just try just singing open vowel sounds and just see if you can sing like a legato note over the top of it and see if it eventually helps you kind of break free from that. All right.
All right. The next one here is from Tim Farnsworth. I can't see the other capos up close, but my partial Kaiser capo have an additional trigger on the top of a cushion that can be pressed down. How do these triggers work?
Yeah. So you have the K lever, which is basically I don't know if there's like five different ones, but they have the K lever capos, which are the original ones are these exact same capos, except there's a little pad where this would be covered, and a little button. So that's the one that you have. And basically all that is doing, that is your assistance for when I was demonstrating the E minor chord. Here I'm having to reach it around, but on your K lever, you just push that button down. So that's what those are doing. You don't have to use them at all until you want to play an E minor chord, which you can still just reach around like I was doing and just fret it. But you've got the option, if that's too much of a stretch to get behind the capo, you can push down. However, to my hands, that feels more unnatural to have this finger not connected to the neck of the guitar and pushing a button as opposed to bringing it down and actually touching the neck. So that's the only difference. So I'm assuming that you maybe have the drop D where it just has the one string. I'm trying to position it so you can see it, where it just has the one string missing, and the shortcut version where it has the low string cut out and the top two cut off. I know there's other ones that have a bigger gap in the middle as well, but I think that those buttons always cover one and or two strings. So the other ones I can't speak directly for because I don't have them, just because this is what I've used for years and I love all the choices I can get from them. So give those a try.
All right, the next question is from Jen Lee. Are there different capos to use with an electric guitar?
Yeah, so Kaiser makes electric capo versions, and basically what they are, because typically electric necks are narrower, and the string gauges are lighter. So the lighter the gauge of the string, the more, when you put a capo on, the pressure is going to pull those strings even more in terms of like pulling them sharp. So Kaiser has versions where they just don't have as much clamping power, and that'll work for you. And they're typically a little smaller just because the acoustic guitar and the strings are so heavy that it's just got to be, it's a little beefier of a pinch. But there are other capos made by, like, say, Shub, and it has like a little knob on the back so you can adjust the amount of pressure. So that one clamps down. You can't put them up here, but there's a G7 capo, which again is kind of a pressure-based one. It slides over the top and you just pinch it down. So take a look at those as well. Otherwise, if you're looking at the Kaisers, just make sure you're asking for an electric one. And they also make them for 12 strings because the 12 strings necks are a little bit not only wider this way, but there's, again, as the last gentleman said, there's twice as many strings on it. So it needs even more clamping power. So they'll have one that's a little stronger for it.
All right. The next question here isn't really about capos, but since you're an engineer guy, which is better to record an acoustic guitar on, a multi-track recorder, a condenser mic, or a sound hole pickup?
So if you want to record like you're recording a song, I would always say sound hole pickup, you know, like, so I've got a magnetic pickup in here, but this is for live applications more so. Any pickup that you have in your guitar and you want to plug in to record, if this is for like something you want to release and share, you're always going to get a better sound from using a microphone externally. These pickups are meant to capture sound, amplify them loudly without feedback in a live setting. On their own, they usually sound like garbage. Most of them do, especially if it's a stock pickup. So an external mic is always going to get... The reason you bought your guitar probably is that you loved the sound of it. And a pickup that's installed in your guitar is not going to sound like the guitar that you hear in the room when you play it. A microphone is going to sound like the guitar that you play, that you're playing. However, the one tricky thing about that is just learning mic placement and finding a good place that captures the body of the guitar but doesn't get too boomy or too tinny. And as just a general starting, it varies from guitar to guitar, but a general starting area is putting a guitar, say, 12 to 18 inches out, more or less faced at where the neck joins the body of the guitar. So around the 4th fret, unless you have a 12th fret guitar, and maybe sometimes your guitar is joining at the 12th fret. More or less in this general area, pointed here. If you put the microphone right in front of the sound hole, it's going to be too boomy because there's a lot of low-end energy that's coming straight out of here. So in a combination of that position and then sometimes turning it on or off axis, meaning either pointed directly at the guitar or slightly angled, and coming in at this direction is another option. So I would recommend that over doing a pickup to record anytime. However, since you have the option to, if you have multi-tracks, also take the direct, and you might be able to use that, like if you want to send something through effects, it's sometimes nice to have something that doesn't have any of the room sounds. Like if you're going to sing and play guitar at the same time, that pickup, unless it's a little microphone inside, that pickup is not going to have any of your vocals in it. So then all of a sudden you do have some of that source that doesn't have any of the bleed of anything else that's happening in the room. So your best sound is going to come from that microphone, but if you've got more than one track, take the direct, take the pickup as well, and blend it into taste, because you might be able to use other things on that direct source just to have for a little more of an effect.
All right, and we do have an entire series on recording and miking techniques for acoustics on the site as well, so check that out. It's from Chris Lipe. It's in phase two. So awesome stuff there. There have been some questions throughout the day about whether this will be available later. Yes, all of these are archived. They will be available on live stream here or on our YouTube channel, which is youtube.com/jamplay.com, spelled D-O-T, com, C-O-M. So you can get it there after as well. Next question is from Tropical, and they ask, have you tried the spider capo?
I have once, and the spider capo is one that sits over the neck and it has six separate little sliders, like one for each string, so you can kind of flip them on or off, so you can change up, the voicing even further. So there's a lot of options, obviously, depending on, you always at least have to have two down, otherwise the thing's going to tip over, is from my understanding of it. But you could have the two outermost ones capoed and the other ones all open, which again, as you move up the neck, you'd still have options back here. A lot of instrumental fingerstyle guitar players I've seen, when they use that, they'll do stuff in the middle of the song where they can flip a note on or off, which is pretty kind of a cool effect. I don't use it for what I do. I get a lot of great things out of these other three capos, and so... beyond that, it's kind of, I've already departed from the idea of being able to show up with an acoustic guitar and play any one of my songs, because I tend to rely on using these because of the sounds that they give me. Now, you throw a spider capo on top of that, you won't be able to leave home. It'll be like your American Express. You can't leave home without it. Otherwise, you won't be able to play any of your songs because you can't do that without, some of those tricks without it. So there's pros and cons to using any of these little gadgets. So...
Wow, I'm just clicking all over the place here. Sorry about that. All right. Next question is from Sunwoo Chong. Are screw capos better than trigger capos?
I'm assuming what you're meaning is if you're calling this a trigger capo, meaning it's just like a squeeze and clamp, and the screw capo is like the shove that actually has like a little adjustable knob in the back. I found that these work really great on my guitar, and I've had no complaints, so I've never had any reason to switch. If you have, say, a Martin, a lot of times has a wider neck, you might find that this squeezes too tightly, or it's just kind of you kind of have to squeeze hard. And so, like, you may say, like, I don't like having to squeeze that, you know, that hard with my left hand. So the screw capos just kind of slip on, clamp down, and it has a little screw knob on the back, so you can control how tight it is. So that's a pretty subjective thing. It's going to depend on your guitar and what you prefer. Because I do so many shows, I'm in different places. I love the convenience of how I can move things on here. The other great thing about these that you can't do with a shub is there's a song, like if I want to change the key in the middle of a song or do a modulation, I have the option to like... I can do a quick, they're called quick change capos because I can grab it and move it. A shub, I would have to use two hands and unclip it and move it and snap it back down. Granted, if you're not planning on doing modulations in your songs like that involving a capo, then maybe you don't need it. But again, subjective answer. It's going to depend on the situation. But they both do essentially the same thing, and it's going to depend on, you may find that one works better on your guitar but doesn't work better on somebody else's guitar.
Excellent. Next question here is from Ray Rousey. Does the capo replace the need to use a bar chord?
A lot of people wish it did. Bar chords will be your friend long term if you once you get accustomed to them. They won't hurt nearly as much. I'm assuming maybe that's why you're asking the question, because even a capo, wherever I put this, depending on the key I'm in, there's still things I'm going to have to bar as I go up. So it doesn't eliminate the need to do bar chords. However, as I was saying, like with the shortcut capo, it was simplifying. Granted, these are all open chords, D, G, and A. Let me see, like an example, when I was up here, going C, F, that's a bar chord, but because I've got the partial capo on, I can take the top two fingers off, so you can see there. So I'm not having to fret those. So that eliminates a bar chord there. So in certain instances, it will free you from having to do the bar chord, but you're not going to get away from them, 100%. So.
All right. The next one is from Andre Lopez. Looks like this may have been in response to something specific that you said, but he asked, does that mean that capos can work as a shortcut to playing lots of different chords as a beginner?
Yes. Yeah. So short answer is yes. And as I mentioned, you know, like when you use it, I could say, here I'm playing that G chord with the shortcut capo. It's not covering the top two strings. I'm essentially playing a G9 chord. Whether or not I know that is kind of irrelevant at this point. I'm a big believer in knowing your theory. However, you don't have to know it in order to play, whether with or without a capo. What this gives us is it gives us these richer chords without necessarily knowing why it's richer or what the suspended notes are. So we've all looked at those monstrous chord charts, and it's like, here's 100 different ways to play an E minor chord. And yes, you can learn all those, and there's value to that. But what I love about this is it becomes subjective instead of objective. I get to say, I like the sound of it. I don't know what the note is. And if I want to figure it out, I can. But for now, I know that I like it, and so I'm going to use it. And here's an example. The E minor chord. Like, I'm not covering the top two strings. So right there, those bottom four strings, that's just a regular E minor chord at this point. But when I throw that note on there, I know that I like it. That's all I need to know. However, if I want to understand why I like it, I could say, well, if I was barring the entire thing, this note here on the second string would be the fifth of the chord, which by not covering it means that it's a suspended fourth. And then the top E string that's open, if I were barring it and covering it like this full chord would it normally have, that note would be the octave, but by not covering it, it's a minor seventh. So now in this E minor chord, I've got a suspended fourth and a minor seventh. okay, now I know that. Do I think about that every time I'm playing it? No, I don't. I just know that that's the voicing that I like. Or if I felt like, you know, in this song I really want it to be the natural chord without any suspended notes, then I've got the option to do that. So you do get these more complex sounding chords without having to know what they are, but, and that's where you start. That's why we start playing music in the first place, or why we fall in love with the guitar, because we love the way it sounds, not because we understand every relationship from string to string. So that's where I feel like some people will call these cheaters. I think they're, to me, they're door openers. They're a way to further fall in love with the music that you're able to make even before you understand why it is that you love it. So that's the way I see it.
Excellent. We're just about ready to get Jim Deeming in here, so we've got one last question for Justin before we kick him out of the studio and bring Jim in. If you are a JamPlay member or if you're thinking about becoming one, definitely check out his series on JamPlay. It's excellent. If you like capos, there are other lesson series on the site as well. We have series from Trace Bundy, Khaki King, Randall Williams. Man, we have all kinds of stuff on capos. So,
we'll if you, do some more with Justin, too.
Yep, and yes, we will likely do more with Justin as well. So last question here, and this is from Rich O'Connor. He asks, can you achieve an open E tuning?
With one of these capos? Not entirely, because I don't think you can actually get any open tuning. This is maybe another workshop to describe the difference between an open tuning and an altered tuning. An open tuning is where every note that you play strummed open is a chord, meaning it's more often than not it is just the root, the fifth, root, the third, and the fifth, and then there'll be octaves and in there or doubles. So there's really, it's just an open tuning is really just drawing from the triad of the chord, the root, third, and fifth, and then of course you have six strings, so there's going to be some doubles or octaves. So in all, so that's an open tuning, and because there is no, you know, as I move these up, I'm always in this position, I'm always keeping this, I think just the way that the guitar is strung, I'm never going to get to a place where I've got a third and only adding another octave or a fifth to the spot. It's like here, like that's got a fourth on it and a seventh. And so I'm not gonna get an open tuning from it, but I will get an altered tuning, which is like what this one is. Like I said, it's like dadgad, which is essentially would be called dadgad on its own is called a modal tuning because it's only got, it doesn't have a third in it. So this one is kind of a modal tuning. It's got a root, a fifth, a root, or an octave, a fourth, a fifth, and an octave. So there's no third. So this can either be major or minor. And that requires knowing where some of those notes are to figure out where the third goes. So this is going to lend itself more to like a modal tuning or an altered tuning where it's going to have some suspensions built into it. So it's not going to help you with like playing slide, say if that's where the question's coming from, to be able to do that. Because anytime I use a slide, anything above the capo is still in standard. So it's still going to just sound like I put a slide on a standard guitar for anything above the capo. So hopefully that answered the question.